Brushy Mountain State Penitentiary. For most prisoners, coming here is a one-way ticket. This place is filled with Tennessee's most violent criminals. To be an inmate here is to live in fear. The odds of breaking out of this place once you've sent here, no matter how ingenious a criminal you are very low. The man who decides he'll take those odds is one of the most infamous assassins in American history. April 4th, 1968, Memphis, Tennessee. Martin Luther King Jr. is killed by a shot from a .30-caliber rifle. Petty criminal James Earl Ray is arrested and pleads guilty to King's murder. Sentenced to 99 years in prison, Ray arrives at Brushy Mountain in March 1970. Ray enters the prison system there with a well-earned reputation for escaping. Ray spends months poking around his cell looking for weak spots. He decides it's too risky to attempt sawing his way through the bars, so his attention turns to the air vent at the back of the cell. He chips away at the hole night after night, replacing the vent every morning and covering his tracks.
Once it got big enough, then he went through that hole and would get in what we would call the pipe chase, which is just access to the plumbing.
Ray explores the pipe chase and spots a potential escape route, a large exhaust fan that vents air to an enclosed courtyard area outside. If he can get through there, Ray estimates that he can crawl to a manhole 20 feet away. He realizes he's going to need help from someone on the outside to get him a saw blade. The murderer turns to his brother, Jerry.
Jerry cuts off the bottom of his shoe and inserts very small hacksaw blades and then attaches the bottom of the shoe. He goes into the prison for a visit. They wait for the guard to go to the back of the visiting room, and they casually shuffle their shoes off and switch shoes.
Ray is able to smuggle the blades back to his cell undetected. He spends the next several months sawing through the bars in the pipe chase. But once again, Ray's plan hits a snag. The thick fan blades behind the bars are nearly impossible to bend. He needs an accomplice to help bend the blades. He turns to one of his few friends in prison, Jake Morlock. Morlock agrees to escape with Ray and steals a pipe wrench they can use to bend the fan blades. Working as quickly and quietly as possible, Ray and Morlock finish removing the bars and bend the fan blades back with the pipe wrench.
James Earl Ray slithered right out through there. His poor cellmate, Jake, was a little bit overweight, and so he couldn't get through, and he had to turn around and go back to the cell.
Back at the prison, Ray has made it out of the pipe chase and into the prison courtyard.
Then the manhole was over here that led outside to the powerhouse down on the road where you come in. They took the lid off of it and the steam was still on.
Ray gets a face full of steam. The pain is almost unbearable. He climbs down anyway.
Those pipes were so hot that they burned him so badly that he had no choice but to turn around and go back.
James Earl Ray is treated in the infirmary for second and third degree burns. James Earl Ray and Jake Morlock each get 2 months in the hole for their escape attempt. Ray bides his time until the spring of 1977, when one day, out in the yard, he notices something peculiar where the prison wall meets the mountainside.
In one spot, there's about an 18-inch gap between the wire and the wall, just enough for a man to slide under.
So he got with a fellow named Shelton, and they talked about it.
Doug Shelton is another career escapee. He has a reputation for breaking out of jails and prisons. He loves the idea. He loves that it's simple, easy, quick. He and Ray basically are made for each other on this.
He was the plumber, and he would have had access to different tools, different plumbing material. And over a course of time, he was able to put away a piece here and a piece there.
Ray brings one more member onto his escape team, his cellmate, Earl Hill. The team slowly steals more pipes and hides them at the back of the yard. On the evening of June 9th, 1977, James Earl Ray, Doug Shelton, and Earl Hill huddle up for one last meeting in the prison yard. They decide they have enough pieces of pipe to reach the top of the wall. Tomorrow, June 10th, they're going over the top.
They had a guy to start a fake fight down on the lower part of the yard. James and Doug and all of them were walking around the yard. They noticed the officer in the tower wasn't paying attention.
Ray and his co-conspirators make one last lap around the yard to give the signal for the fight to begin.
When the fight breaks out and these three guys head to the spot at the wall and immediately whip out their sections of pipe, start whirling them together.
Once they needed it, they put it together just in a few seconds. They made a hook on the top similar to a shepherd's hook so that it would stay attached to the wall. When they put it up, it would hook on the backside.
Everything is going as planned. With the ladder assembled, Ray, Sheldon, and Hill head for the wall.
James Earl Ray makes his way over the wall first, followed by Doug Shelton and Earl Hill. Other inmates see the ladder, and they seize the opportunity. You have Larry Hacker, Donald Kaler, Jerry Ward. David Lee Powell is working in the kitchen and sees the action from the window and decides he wants in. He starts running across the yard to make it to the ladder. He's wearing a white kitchen uniform. That catches a guard's eye, and he turns and takes aim at the ladder. David makes it over. Jerry Ward is bringing up the rear. He's shot off the ladder and lands in the middle of the courtyard. All the inmates are getting in on the act. Everybody starts cheering, over the wall, which was apparently the popular cry whenever anybody was trying to get out.
As the sun begins to set, a total of six escapees are fighting their way through the rugged mountains of eastern Tennessee. The guards at Brushy Mountain scramble to lock the prison down, organize a manhunt, and alert the townspeople. As night falls, they go their separate ways. Ray is alone in the harsh, snake-infested mountains, trying to find his way to nearby Route 116. Meanwhile, hundreds of law enforcement agents from across the country descend on the area.
This little community was turned upside down. I mean, there's only 500 people that live here. And when you've got ABC, NBC, CBS, every news agency in the country, biggest thing to hit this place a long time.
About 10:30 that night, the dogs get a scent and they take off. Takes them over the railroad, up the mountains, through the woods, drags on for about 3 hours. Around 2 a.m., the dogs stop and alert on a pile of leaves. And under the pile of leaves is James Earl Ray.
James Earl Ray tried to escape from Brushy Mountain again 2 years later, but was caught before he could even get over the wall. He spent the rest of his life behind bars, yet always maintained his innocence. In 1998, gravely ill with hepatitis, Ray told a reporter, "If they're waiting for a deathbed confession, they can go to hell."